Subarachnoid Haemorrhage, Level Basic, Version Number 1, Version Date, May 2012, by Dr. Matthew Robertson and Dr. Jessica McFarlane. Affiliation, Division of Neurology, Duke University Medical Center. Learning Objectives: to understand the epidemiology, clinical presentation, complications, treatment, and prognosis of subarachnoid haemorrhage, SAH. Outline: we will discuss epidemiology, risk factors, pathophysiology, clinical symptoms, diagnosis, complications, treatment, and prognosis related to SAH. Epidemiology: the prevalence of intracranial saccular aneurysms by radiographic and autopsy series is 5%, or 10 to 15 million people in the United States. Approximately 20 to 30% of patients have multiple aneurysms. The average incidence of subarachnoid haemorrhage is 9.1 per 100,000 annually. Studies from different countries have shown differing rates, as high as 22.7 per 100,000 in Japan, down to 4.1 per 100,000 in some South and Central American countries. In North America, this translates into approximately 30,000 subarachnoid haemorrhages per year. Thus, most aneurysms don't rupture. Although the group of people at risk for subarachnoid haemorrhage is younger than the population usually affected by stroke, the risk still increases with age. As you can see in the graph on the right, the risk continues to rise with age and is 60% higher in the very elderly, over 85, when compared to those between 45 and 55. Risk factors associated with subarachnoid haemorrhage. Some risk factors you are born with. First-degree relatives of patients of subarachnoid haemorrhage have 3- to 5-fold increased risk of SAH compared with the general population. Others, such as autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, and other connective tissue disorders are also non-modifiable. Alcohol use, cigarette smoking, drug use, hypertension are risk factors that can be potentially limited with intervention. Approximately 4% of aneurysmal bleeds occur after sexual intercourse, and 10% of people with subarachnoid haemorrhage are bending over or lifting heavy objects at the onset of their symptoms. Pathophysiology of subarachnoid haemorrhage. In 85% of cases of spontaneous subarachnoid haemorrhage, the cause is rupture of a cerebral aneurysm. Aneurysms are most common around the circle of Willis, along the anterior communicating artery, which accounts for 30% of aneurysmal SAH, along the posterior communicating artery, which accounts for 25% of aneurysmal SAH, and along the middle cerebral artery, which accounts for 20% of aneurysmal SAH. Aneurysms tend to form at arterial branch points or bifurcations. 85% of aneurysms arise from the anterior circulation, while the remaining 15% occur in the posterior circulation. As a general rule, the larger the aneurysm, the more likely it is to bleed. Subarachnoid blood can be detected on CT scanning in as many as 60% of people with traumatic brain injury. Traumatic subarachnoid haemorrhage usually tends to occur near the site of a skull fracture or intracerebrally. In 15 to 20% of cases of spontaneous subarachnoid haemorrhage, no aneurysm is detected on the first angiogram. About half of these are attributed to non-aneurysmal perimesencephalic haemorrhage, in which the blood is limited to the subarachnoid spaces around the midbrain. In these, the origin of blood is uncertain. Other rarer causes of subarachnoid haemorrhage include arteriovenous malformations and pituitary apoplexy. Symptoms and presentation associated with subarachnoid haemorrhage. Abrupt thunderclap headache is present in up to 97% of cases and is classically described as the worst headache of my life. However, up to 12% of subarachnoid haemorrhages are misdiagnosed upon presentation due to mild symptoms. Patients may have sentinel bleeds or small leaks leading to mild symptoms. The likelihood that this occult aneurysm will rebleed is great. Headache is lateralized in 30% of patients, predominantly to the side of the aneurysm. Anisocoria, or pupillary asymmetry that is seen in the image here, may precede bleeding if secondary to PCOM compression of the oculomotor nerve. Brief loss of consciousness, seizure, and nausea or vomiting can also be seen. Meningismus and lower back pain are common, but are usually delayed several hours after the bleed since it is caused by the breakdown of blood products within the CSF, which can lead to an aseptic meningitis. Only 10% of people admitted to the emergency department with a thunderclap headache are suffering from a subarachnoid hemorrhage. Thus, other possible causes are usually considered simultaneously, such as meningitis, migraine, and cerebral venous sinus thrombosis. Intracranial hemorrhage, in which bleeding occurs within the brain itself, is twice as common as subarachnoid hemorrhage and is often misdiagnosed as the latter. It is not unusual for subarachnoid hemorrhage to be initially misdiagnosed as migraine or tension headache, which can lead to delay in obtaining a CT scan, which in turn can lead to a worse outcome. In some people, the headache resolves by itself and no other symptoms are present. This type of headache is referred to as a sentinel headache because it is presumed to result from a small leak from an aneurysm. A sentinel headache still warrants investigation with a CT scan and lumbar puncture, as further bleeding may occur in the subsequent 3 weeks. Diagnosis of subarachnoid hemorrhage. The modality of choice is computed tomography, CT scan of the brain. This has a high sensitivity and will correctly identify over 95% of cases, especially on the first day after this onset of bleeding. Magnetic resonance imaging, or MRI, may be more sensitive than CT scan after several days. Lumbar puncture, in which cerebrospinal fluid is removed with a needle from the lumbar sac, will show evidence of hemorrhage in 3% of people in whom a CT scan was normal. Lumbar puncture is therefore regarded as mandatory in people with suspected subarachnoid hemorrhage if imaging is negative. Typically, 4 tubes of CSF are obtained. If an elevated number of red blood cells is present equally in all bottles, this indicates a subarachnoid hemorrhage. If the number of cells decreases per bottle, it is more likely that this is due to a damage to a small blood vessel during the procedure known as a traumatic tap. The CSF sample is also examined for xanthochromia, or the yellowing appearance of centrifugated fluid. An interval of at least 12 hours between the onset of the headache and lumbar puncture is required for xanthochromia, as it takes several hours for the hemoglobin of the red blood cells to be metabolized into bilirubin, creating the yellowing of the CSF. Diagnosis of subarachnoid hemorrhage continued. For visualization of the aneurysm, two radiographic techniques are often employed. CT angiography is a quick and non-invasive tool to identify and characterize an aneurysm. Conventional angiography is also used. While there are more potential complications with conventional angiography, such as stroke, it can be used for not only diagnosing aneurysms, but also for treating them too, through coiling, as can be seen in the images on the right. Treatment of subarachnoid hemorrhage. If a cerebral aneurysm is identified on angiography, two measures are available to reduce the risk of further bleeding from the same aneurysm: clipping and coiling. Clipping requires a craniotomy, or opening of the skull, to locate the aneurysm, followed by the placement of clips around the neck of the aneurysm. Coiling is performed through the large blood vessels, or endovascularly. During this procedure, a catheter is inserted into the femoral artery in the groin and advanced through the aorta to the arteries of the brain, both the carotids and the vertebrals. When an aneurysm has been located, platinum coils are deployed that cause a blood clot to form in the aneurysm, obliterating it. The decision as to which treatment is undertaken is typically made by a multidisciplinary team consisting of a neurosurgeon, a neuroradiologist, and other health professionals. Generally, the decision between clipping and coiling is made on the basis of the location of the aneurysm, its size, and the condition of the patient. Aneurysms of the middle cerebral artery and its related vessels are hard to reach with angiography and tend to be amenable to clipping. Those of the basilar artery and posterior cerebral artery are hard to reach surgically and are more accessible for endovascular coiling. Patients are always admitted to the intensive care setting for a constant hemodynamic monitoring. Stool softeners are often given to prevent straining, bed rest is mandated until the aneurysm is secured, analgesia is often given to diminish hemodynamic fluctuations, DVT or deep venous thrombosis prophylaxis with pneumatic compression stockings is mandated, and transcranial Dopplers are often employed to monitor for cerebral vasospasm. The picture immediately to the right represents an artist's depiction of transcranial Dopplers insinuating the middle cerebral artery. The picture further to the right depicts a craniotomy procedure. Complications of subarachnoid hemorrhage. Complications include rebleeding from an unsecured or partially secured aneurysm. Vasospasm, in which the blood vessels constrict and thus restrict blood flow, is a serious complication. It can cause ischemic brain injury, referred to as delayed ischemia, and permanent brain damage due to lack of oxygen in parts of the brain. It can be fatal if severe. Delayed ischemia is characterized by new neurologic symptoms and can be confirmed by transcranial Doppler or cerebral angiography. About one-third of all people admitted with subarachnoid hemorrhage will have delayed ischemia, and half of those suffer permanent damage as a result. It is possible to screen for the development of vasospasm with transcranial Dopplers every 24 to 48 hours. Hydrocephalus is also a common side effect. This can be seen in the axial CT image on the right, and may develop from the inflammatory effects of blood products in the subarachnoid space, thus creating obstructed CSF flow. Hydrocephalus can lead to a depressed level of consciousness and brain herniation if left untreated. Electrolyte abnormalities such as hyponatremia are also common and are thought to be secondary to SIADH and or cerebral salt wasting. Cardiac sequelae can be seen from the systemic adrenergic stress response. Takotsubo's cardiomyopathy or apical ballooning, as seen in the angiographic image to the right, is a common side effect, as are NSTEMIs. Prognosis. The death rate or mortality for subarachnoid hemorrhage is between 40 and 50%, but trends for survival are improving. 10% of patients with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage die prior to reaching the hospital, 25% die within 24 hours, 45% die within 30 days. Of those who survive hospitalization, more than a quarter have significant restrictions in their lifestyle, and less than a fifth have no residual symptoms whatsoever. Delay in diagnosis of minor subarachnoid hemorrhage contributes to poor outcome. Factors found on admission that are associated with poorer outcome include neurological grade, systolic hypertension, a previous diagnosis of heart attack or subarachnoid hemorrhage, liver disease, more blood on initial scan, and a larger aneurysm on the initial CT scan. Location of the aneurysm in the posterior circulation and a higher age have also had negative factors. Factors that carry a worse prognosis during the hospital stay include occurrence of delayed ischemia resulting from vasospasm, development of intracerebral hematoma or intraventricular hemorrhage, and presence of fever on the eighth day of admission. Neurocognitive symptoms such as fatigue, mood disturbances, and other related symptoms are common sequelae. Even in those who have made good neurological recovery, anxiety, depression, and post-traumatic stress disorder, as well as cognitive impairment, are common. 46% of people who have suffered a subarachnoid hemorrhage have cognitive impairment that affects the quality of their life. Over 60% report frequent headaches. Summary. Subarachnoid hemorrhage is associated with high morbidity and mortality. Lumbar puncture and CT scan, as well as history, are essential for diagnosis. Coiling or clipping to secure an aneurysm is the definitive treatment. Supportive care helps reduce the impact of complications, such as vasospasm.